Now that we have our event frame generation analysis set up with an output attribute along with our multiple start triggers and end trigger, let's go ahead and run our analysis and we'll see how these events are captured. To begin, I will check in all of my changes. And now that I have the green check mark, I can see that my analysis has started up. I'm going to manually edit the values in order to generate an event frame. Looks like the current value is drawdown testing. To get a clean slate, I'm going to set it to running. One thing that I haven't noted is that my analysis is set to be event triggered. And I can see that my different triggers are listed below. In this particular case, the only thing that affects my start and end triggers are my status message. So only when the status message changes is when this will look to evaluate the event frame generation analysis. You can notice that this does not depend on the casing temperature at all. The casing temperature is only going to be used to take a look at this output attribute, but it does not start or end the event frame. So it is not considered as a trigger for my event triggered schedule. I'll go back and manipulate the data again, and we'll choose down as a status message. Once we change the status message, we'll assume that our event frame generation analysis has run, and then we can look over on the event frames tab and take a look for our event frames that are created. I'll do a new search by right-clicking. And I'm only concerned with this particular event frame template. So I'll choose the downtime severity template. We can see that my original event popped up. We can get rid of this once we're done with it. And we can also take a look at the new event frame that has just started up. In this particular case, we can get rid of our originally manually created event frame. And when we look back, we can see that the arrow to the right indicates this event frame is still open. We expect this event frame to remain open as long as we do not change the status message back to running. In order to show what a completely closed event frame looks like, let's go ahead and close the status message by putting it to running. And once this change is picked up, we'll see that the event frame closes. I'll apply my changes. In this case, it is getting rid of the deleted event frame. And we can see that the event frame has closed. I can see some more parameters if I scroll over to the right. We can see the severity as well as the template and the primary reference element. We can also change these columns and include our attributes if we would like. We can see that the casing temperature between the start and end did not change, therefore our delta is zero. And we can see the status message showed down, and again, that down attribute was used in the naming of this event frame, which picked up well29 downtime severity as the template, and then down as the attribute, and then the start time of the event frame. That first piece of well29 was from the element that it was created from. Last but not least, if we're happy with how this all looks, we can go ahead and we can convert this to the template. We go back on our element, back to our event frame generation analysis, We can right-click and convert it to template. A couple of things to point out. In later videos, we'll talk about creating notification rules off of event frames. You can see a link here on the right saying create a new notification rule for downtime severity. So this is a possible technique. In later videos, we'll discuss how child event frames are created using these multiple start triggers, as well as the difference between recapturing and recalculating our event frames.